Check. Check. Ja, werkt ook. Heel goed. Oh, hij is van het streamen. Cool. Heb ik zelf gedaan. Oh damn, ik heb verkeerde scherm. From the Groovy Bands production team studios in the Netherlands, my name is Mixmaster G and welcome to this live stream. It's 7 o'clock in the Netherlands, time to talk a little bit about collection management and conversion for DJs, because that's why I do this stream. Excuse me that I'm a little bit later than normal due to technical difficulties. Actually, it was a very rainy, dark day in the Netherlands, whole day, and look at the windows behind me. All of a sudden, the sun came through. So the stream starts, the sun comes out, which means my cam is blinded. So that's why there is a little bit of a different angle this time than you might be used to normally. But nevertheless, that should still work for us. Welcome everybody. First of all, let me thank everybody who signed up for the beta program for the iTunes collection tool. I love all your feedback. I love what you're telling me. I'm working on a new release and that will probably be out sometime this week with some new features added. I hope you guys are going to like it. And then we are approaching release date. I still have to think about what price it will be. I still have to think when it will be released, but things are progressing nicely. I don't have a very loaded AMA this time around. Basically, I've got two questions I'm going to work with that were asked previously. First of all, there was an artist asking me how you can use my tools to convert from virtual DJ to a Denon Prime player, and that is what I'm going to show indeed. And then there was another question laying around about the sorting order on Pioneer CDJs, meaning on my Nexus 2 kit, and I will dive into that as well. So those are basically the two questions for this AMA stream. Nevertheless, if you've got questions, things you want to know, things you always wanted to know but never dare to ask, ask them in the chat. Yvette is monitoring the chat and she will alert me if there are questions that need an answer, basically. So let's get into it. And first of all, virtual DJ. You are going to see me looking the other way, and that is because my main screen is right in front of me, which means I'm going to look like this instead of that, which means I'm not looking into the cam. But again, if I put the cam on its normal, usual spot, then it is blinded. I can give it a little try. Hold on. Let's see. Ah, that's not too bad. That's not too bad. All right, let's work from this. That's more personal. Then I can look you in the eye and you can look me back, and that makes things a little bit more personal than from the side view. Virtual DJ to Engine Prime. That means you basically need two of my tools. Actually, you need three, but two of them come bundled. So let me wrap it up. You need the DJ conversion utility and you need the Denon conversion utility. You need them both. What will happen is we are going to use the DJ conversion utility to convert from Virtual DJ to Rekordbox XML, and we are not going to Rekordbox. I cannot tell that enough. The Rekordbox XML is just a transmission mechanism. If you don't want to go to Rekordbox, if you don't need Rekordbox, you can quit Rekordbox. You don't need to go to Rekordbox, period. All we do is just basically use the Rekordbox XML transmission mechanism. And then I start up the collection backup tool, which will make a complete drive that works in Virtual DJ. I'm going to eject the terabyte. We don't need that. You can already see the Prutz drive right in the corner. And let's, for good measures, format it. Again, if you are going to Denon Prime equipment, it needs preferably be an XFAT master boot record formatted drive, and always name your drives appropriately so you know what's on that drive. Users of the MCX8000 with the Engine Prime compatible firmware, you need to go to FAT. You cannot go to XFAT. There are other limitations, but that is the biggest one you need to be aware of. MCX, FAT, everything else, XFAT. XFAT by far the preferred because it doesn't have the file size limitations that FAT has. And I hear you always think, hey, Mixmaster G, but I don't have audio tracks that are 4 gigabytes. It's not about the audio tracks, it's about the size of the iTunes or the Denon Prime collection database, which can outgrow 4 gigabyte. And the moment it hits 4 gigabyte on a FAT drive, you get the famous corrupt error, and there is no way to prevent that. So that's why I say XFAT whenever possible, because it doesn't have that limitation. All right, back to the program. Virtual DJ. Let me quickly show you what I got in Virtual DJ. This is the new Virtual DJ. I just downloaded it this afternoon. It seems to work fine, but I'm not a Virtual DJ person, so I really don't know a lot about it, only how I can convert from it, because I was the first one to write that. Let's go right here. And we've got an a cappella, and that doesn't have anything. Let me find something. I think the Candy Shop a cappella should have some cues. No, it doesn't. Basically, I'm looking for a track with cues in it, so we can use that. The Rapper's Delight should always have cues. Let's see. And that even doesn't have any hot cues, as you can see. Always nice to have something prepared, isn't it? Which is weird, because usually these tracks have hot cues, because they are coming from my own collection. This one is hot. All right, the Rapture a cappellas has hot cues. You can see it has hot cues, so let's focus on the Rapture a cappella. Important, the DJ conversion utility converts only tracks that are stored in Virtual DJ playlists. And those are those red things you see right here. Anything else will not convert. For instance, this one is a preferred list. It's not a DJ playlist, only a DJ playlist. And you create them by, let's see, create a virtual folder. It's called a virtual folder. And you say where you want it and you give it a name. And then it will create that red test thingy, and only that kind of playlist is being converted by Virtual DJ or by the DJ conversion utility. Basically, for all your non-Virtual DJ users, it's the Virtual DJ crate. It's the same thing as crates in Serato, as crates in Engine Prime. Virtual DJ playlists are playlists, crates, like in Virtual DJ, and tracks need to be in there for the DJ conversion to recognize them. All right, I can quit this. And of course, Virtual DJ is one of those programs which doesn't quit. When you do Command Q, you have to really click it away, and I don't like that. I don't like programs who behave like that. Serato has a way of that too, that you cannot just simply command Q it and then it will quit. It always starts to complain around. But, well, seems to be the nature of the beast. Here we are in the DJ Converge Utility, and of course we are going from Virtual DJ. I leave everything default, I just start converting. And we will automatically be presented with the playlist. And you can see these are the Virtual DJ playlist folders, the red ones in Virtual DJ. And I take the a cappella because there has the Rapture track, and the Rapture track happens to have cues, and that's what we all want to see. So that's why I take the Rapture track. When the DJ Converge Utility is true, it will automatically start Rekordbox 5.6.0, but I immediately quit it. I don't need Rekordbox 5.6.0, because what we are going to do is we are going to start the collection backup tool, CBT. And the collection backup tool, for those who don't know what it is an incremental backup tool. Basically, you can throw a Rekordbox XML or an iTunes XML to it, and you say to it what the target drive is, and it will take all the tracks contained in that XML and copy them over to the target drive and then start the Denon conversion utility. So basically, it is like a reverse order. It's not first put it in Engine Prime and then sync it to a drive. No, this is exactly the opposite. First, we copy everything, we sync everything to the drive, all the tracks or the drive, and then we convert them. Why that way around? There are a lot of storage locations Engine Prime cannot read from. And that means you get those famous incomplete playlists because tracks are stored on file servers, on NAS servers, in the cloud, on external NFS. Copying those tracks first to an XFAT drive makes sure that Engine Prime can read them. That's one of the reasons why the collection backup tool DQ combo always creates complete playlists, because it first makes sure that you can read those tracks. All right, enough about that. You can already see that the Rekordbox DDCU XML, that is the one just created by the DJ Converge Utility, has already been selected, so there's nothing I need to do there. The only thing I have to do is target the Prutz drive as my target drive, and then we start the backup, and everything is basically from here on out on automatic. I don't need to do anything. I can say stay with my hands up and I don't have to mouse, only because I didn't give the proper privileges I have to mouse. There goes another demonstration.
The Denon conversion utility needs your attention.
The famous mid-procedure mandatory analysis in Engine Prime, because otherwise, if we do it afterward, Engine Prime's analysis will override the converter data. So we want to override the analyzed data with converter data, which is what we are going to do. For good measures, let me do it officially. Go to the analyze these first, create. Let me clear this a little bit up so we can see, you can see what we are doing there. And we say, hold on, we say analyze, I quit, I set this to quit Engine Prime, and my hands are off the thing again, because from here on out everything is automatic. There is nothing we need to do. There was one track not analyzed, that might be an incompatible track with Engine Prime, who knows. And here we are again in Engine Prime, but this time around, if we dive a little bit deeper in the converted playlists, and there you see the selected Virtual DJ, and there we have the a cappella, and then we are going to look for the Blondie track. Let me find that one for you. There we are, Rapture, and we load it up, and there we are with the cues. Mind you, this data is coming straight from Virtual DJ. Even the grid comes from Virtual DJ. And here you say, hey, Mixmaster G, but the grid there is rubbish. That's correct. This is an old analog track. And it has a dynamic grid, which is not supported by and your prime. But look at my BPM, 108.1. That's the exact virtual DJ grid, or the exact virtual DJ BPM value. And now for the real fun part, I eject the drive because I'm going to my SC5000 and we are going to connect it there. Let's see. Yep, I'm connected there. Let me grab the drive, which is right here. This is what the famous Prutz drive looks like. And let's switch to the iOS cam. And we need to do that like this. Where am I? Overhead cam. There we are. And there you see the SC5000 already waiting. There is still one of my older drives connected, or actually this is my real performance drive, 2 terabyte drive. This is the Prutz drive. I connect it. You can see I use leads with a bit of extension. This lead is actually connected to the lower back port of the SC5000, which is the only valid USB 3 port with enough power to store to power big drives. So lower back USB is the USB to use, and bring it with an extension to the front so you can just use it. There you can see that the Rapture track was already inside, but just for good measures, let me show you that indeed all my playlists are there. You can see that. And I have to find it again. Let's go for the artist. There we are. And there is our Rapture track. And if I load it, it loads up immediately. And you can see that the cues are indeed right there. So this is how you go from Virtual DJ straight to a Denon Prime drive. You don't see me sync anything in Engine Prime. I just use Engine Prime for the analysis. And I used it to preview what was happened. But this is where the real action happened, right on the SC5000 on the Prime drive. There is a little trick I can share with you Virtual DJ users as well, because I have this app called the Denon Extractor tool, and the Denon Extractor tool takes tracks from the history lists of a Denon performance drive and can convert the cues and loops you set on the player back to a Rekordbox XML. And here you think, hey, but I'm on Virtual DJ, I'm not on Rekordbox. I know, I hear you. However, you can convert with the DJ conversion utility that Rekordbox XML to Serato cues. And Virtual DJ can read Serato cues. So you can go full circle with a little bit of a stop in between. It works, it's not perfect. Why it's not perfect? Because if a track has Virtual DJ cues already in Virtual DJ will prefer those. So you basically have to delete the track for Virtual DJ and put it in again. Then the Serato cues are read by Virtual DJ. But it works, it's a workable solution. So for those who are interested in that, it's all possible. I hope that makes clear how you go from Virtual DJ to a Denon Prime player. Let me first ask if there are any questions. There is a question I see. Let me see what the question is about. Eddie Broom, I haven't started on the beta yet. Can you show how you set up your test library in iTunes, please? Yeah, sure, sure, we can do that. First of all, create... if you don't know how this stuff all works, make it yourself easy and create a macOS temporary account with administrative privileges. How do you do that? You simply go to the System Preferences. There we have the Users and Groups. You unlock it. You press the plus sign, right there. It will ask, what do you want to do? Well, you want to make a new account, and the new account will be an administrator. You call it test. and you fill it in, then the user is created. The next step, if you have created that account, you log out of your normal account like that. You get some warnings and you can log into that newly created account. The benefits of that is that everything you do in that account is completely firewalled from your normal collections. So that makes it a lot easier to separate those, to make sure that nothing happens to your collection that you don't want to happen. Not only for the ICT test, but for everything you just want to try out. If you want to try out Rekordbox 6, for instance, make a temporary account. If you want to play with Virtual DJ 2020, make it. So everything you do in that account is separated. I hear there are some problems with the screen. What's the problem? Because my preview seems to be correct. Can somebody tell me what the problem is with the screen? Because there is somebody in the chat saying there is an issue with the screen, but... Oh, all right. Hold on. I know what... Sorry, my mistake. You're right. Again, let's do that again. Thank you, buddy, for reminding me. My bad. Because if I'm going to show that, you have to have the screen on. That was what he was telling me. I love it when my users will tell me when something is going wrong. And you can see, we can act on it. And I'm only human. I have to do this whole thing by myself together with Yvette as monitor for the chat. So sometimes those things go wrong. Excuses for that. Sorry for that. It might happen again. Again, a new user account. You go to the system preferences. You go to the user and groups system preference. You unlock it like this. You click the little plus sign and you make a new user. You make it the administrator because you want to do everything possible within that user account. And then you click create user. The user will be created after that user has been created. Simply click log out and log in to that newly created user. That's the easy way to do this. Now, how you are going to get tracks in there, you can use a USB from your normal account, put some tracks on it and then copy them into the temp account. For instance, you see those two folders here, those are test accounts for me, or test tracks, which I just dump into the Filmpjes account. Filmpjes is Dutch for movie, for video, for tutorial, for stream. So the Filmpjes account is basically the account I use for demonstrations like this stream. And that is completely firewalled from my normal collection, which is also on this computer. So I'm not worried to do anything wrong in this account because it only stays in this account. Don't forget, if you do this, that you have to set all the preferences again for your tools or for your apps. So for instance, iTunes will require to have the correct preferences like this, and these are the preferences everybody knows Mixmaster G wants to see, but this is how that works. So you have to set it, and not only for iTunes but for Rekordbox, for Traktor, for Serato, every app doesn't have any preferences in here, and some apps might even ask you for your license code. So that depends on how the app is created. For instance, my apps will ask for the license code because the license code is stored inside the user level library and not the system level library. Another thing I'm going to show then, because I can, and it kind of connects to what Eddie was asking. If you go inside the music folder, you have the iTunes folder, and if you are a music user on Catalina, you will have a music folder. This works the same. The moment I delete that iTunes folder, or I rename it, or I throw it away, or whatever, and I empty the trash, I have an empty iTunes collection, but that is an empty iTunes collection without any preferences. And you can see right here, I've got this zip And that chip is called iTunes Empty, and that's exactly what it is. If I unpack that chip, you will see that there is an iTunes folder created again. And now my iTunes will be empty, but with my preferred preferences. Let me show that to you. You see, completely empty, nothing there. This is from the telephone, but there's nothing there. And if you go to the preferences, you can see that, indeed, those are exactly as I want them to be. So, that's a little trick. You can do the same thing with Traktor. You can do the same thing with Rekordbox. And let me show you how that works with Rekordbox. With Rekordbox, you have to do a little trick, because the Rekordbox library or collection, let's name it right, the Rekordbox collection is stored in the user level library. And for that to access, you have to go to the Go menu and press the Alt or the Option key on your keyboard, because look then, the moment I press it, you see library is an option right there. And we go to library. Within the library, you will find a folder named Pioneer, and you see exactly the same thing I just told you with iTunes. You see a couple of zips which are pre-configured Pioneer folders. If I just throw the Pioneer folder away and I empty the bin, that means I have an empty Pioneer folder but without any preferences. If I unzip the Pioneer empty, I have the Pioneer folder with the correct preferences. How do you create a Pioneer empty or an iTunes empty zip? You do that like you start out without anything at all. You go to Rekordbox. You could already see that it was created. And then you are going to fill everything in. You're going to fill your email address and the password. Obviously, I'm not going to do this on a public broadcast, but you got the idea. Once you have done everything and everything is set up the way you want it to be, you just right-click this one and you say Compress Pioneer, and then make sure you give it a name that you know what that is. And then you have a backup of your Pioneer folder. So if I want, for instance, to have an empty Pioneer collection, I just unzip that zip. And if I now start up my Rekordbox, it will not complain about my username, etc. It will have the preferences all the way I want it, and you still have that empty collection. So that's how you do that in Rekordbox. And trust me, it is very convenient to have this kind of stuff. There are some other possibilities. For instance, you can put a Pioneer collection to the side, a Rekordbox collection to the side. For instance, you see Pioneer Grand here, that's left over from something, I don't know what. I think it was testing, and I think Ariana Grande was my focus track or something. But if I hold on, I cannot do that because their name is already taken. But if we throw the empty Pioneer folder away, we rename the Pioneer Grand, and now I can open Rekordbox and I see what happens. Always, when you play with preferences like this, the application needs to be closed, which means you have to quit Rekordbox, and if you do it in iTunes, you have to quit iTunes before you can do it. So you open Rekordbox, you set all your preferences, you quit it, and you make a zip out of it, and then you've got always an empty collection to go back to. I told you this was an Ariana Grande thing, and that was why it was called Grande, so I knew that it was about that. Let's give me a little bit of a collection there. And if I open Rekordbox again, then you can see we are right here at a test collection with some tracks in it. And that brings me to the next subject. Let's first ask if there are any questions. There doesn't seem to be any questions at all, so that's for the easy part. Another question that was asked was about sorting orders on CDJs. And these things can be a drag, especially if you are used to controllers with DJ software, and the DJ software can be Rekordbox, the DJ software can be whatever you like. Then having a CDJ feels very limiting because, yeah, it's somewhat older technology, that's for sure. So let me show you how you can create a CDJ USB proper way, and let me show you how you then can make sure that the sorting order is the order you want, the default sorting order. Let me get some stuff right here. This should do the job. For the more advanced Prutz driver, we have a Samsung T5 drive, indeed. I cannot easily hook that up, I see. Then we just take the Prutz drive back from the SC5000. Which I was about to eject anyway. And we do this just from the start, just the whole kaboom. Here we've got the Prutz drive, and this time we are going to format it FAT-MBR. And why FAT? Because FAT is the most compatible file format on CDJs. I've got the Nexus 2 kit, you will see that in a moment. I can throw any size of drive, any format to it, and it will always work. But if you just make a USB for your keychain, in case you are at a club and there are CDJs and you really don't know what to expect, but you want your tracks to work on them, make your disk FAT. There is no going around that. And let's do that. We erase the icy box and we call it Prutz. And we make it an MS-DOS FAT, which also means that Pioneer or Rekordbox will automatically take it over, because that's how they work. They immediately see that drive and they will take it over. So right now you can see there's nothing on it, and the moment I start Rekordbox you will see the Pioneer stuff appearing. Let's click this one away. You see, there you are already with the Pioneer stuff. Now, I like to use the Sync Manager because that gives me peace of mind. I just know what's on the device and I can just sync it over. So I want the MixMesh playlist or the folder with everything in it. I just click Sync and it will take care of everything to create the CDJ USB. Now, there are some things that are important to know if you want to use it more advanced. First of all, if you click on the Prutz on the devices, then right now you can see that the stuff is there. There are some things there. I really don't know what's on it. Well, you can see there's something there, and you can load it up, and you can see that it cuts queues and loops. So that's all fairly fine. However, there is something else that is important. If you click on the drive name, just on the top level in the tree, you can see a lot of things you can already set on that drive. And I ask you, please do that, because it makes your life a lot easier. For instance, I want full waveforms because I'm used to full waveforms. I don't like those half things. I cannot make anything out of that. Then give it a name. So in case you forget your drive or somebody else finds it, they know whose it is. So just make sure that that information is there. Then the various categories you want to have on the playlist, that's okay. What is important, and what that question of that artist was about, is this one, the sorting. And you want to make sure that your sorting is there. I always have the comments as my primary sort field, so I add that to the active sorting options. However, I wanted to make it the most important one, which means I select it and click up, 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 up. So it's on top of the list, which means the moment I'm down into a playlist on my CDJ, it will be sorted on command. And I will show you in a moment why that is so important for me, because it's part of my workflow. Then this one is important too. What do you want to show next to the track name? I want my commands to be shown which means that the moment a track is playing on the CDJ, it will show the comment. And in a moment I will show you why. Then there are some other settings right here. For instance, how do you want the play mode to be? And those are all taken from the basic preferences. So these are these preferences right here under devices. Let me find it. And here you can set how you want them to be. So I want my playlist to be single, unlocked. Let's see, what else do we have? I don't want any quant size at all, but we are going to set that off later on. Hotkey auto load, I want to be on. Hotkey color, I want to be on. Where am I? The sleep mode flashing, I want on. Where I want bright, that one I want on. So you basically work through those lists and see if they are the way you want them to be. You can see here quant size, I want that to be off, I want my sync off, I want my master tempo on so I can see what's going on inside there. And that's how you set that. And the moment you have set it, and you go back to here. Oh, here we have the phase meter. That's the phase meter was the one I was looking for. The phase meter is the phase indicator on the CDJ. There are two types. Right now it's type 1, and I think type 2 is the one I like more, because type 1 is the famous blocks flashing, and type 2 is a little bit closer to what I'm used to in Traktor. And you can watch one of my previous streams where I talk in length about the phase indicator of Traktor and my love for that. So let me find the phase indicator, because it should be there somewhere inside the list. Here it is. Let's change it to type 2, because that was what I was looking for the other day I showed a CDJ. So basically I have set this all in the preferences, and as you can see, it's a kind of a mixed bag. Some of those settings you have to do in the RecordBox preferences, and then they are put on the actual drive, and some of them you can change right here. So it's a little bit of a mixed bag. It's not an ideal system, but okay, it kind of works, and it's the way this is supposed to work. For security reasons, I just do a quick sync again, nothing to sync there, but just to make sure that those settings are there, and then I can eject the drive and we can go to the CDJs. Let me grab my overhead cam so we can see what's going on there. Hold on. This should do the job nicely. Let's see what happens if I activate it. There we are, CDJs, yay. And let's make sure that you can see it. I hope the screen is readable like that, but otherwise I think it's about the best I can do. I can zoom a little bit. Doesn't get any much better than that, folks. So this is it for now. I take my Plutz drive, which already was ejected, and I take a cord with me, because now I have to connect it through a cord. Always three ways to insert the USB, and one of these days I'm going to get that right. But you can already see that, you see that quickly disappearing. There was a message on screen telling me there is a My Settings found, and we want to load it. And I want to load that because those are those settings I just had. If you press the menu button, you can still say load, and you see your settings were loaded to the player. which is what I wanted. Now, if you go inside the playlist, and you see right there the playlist, and you click on it, you see that it's sorted on command field. There's a space in front of that one, so that's why the 12 is not correct. But for the rest, you can see everything is sorted there, but not alphabetically sorted. I don't know why it's not alphabetically sorting this way. It should have been, but at least you can see it is showing the command field next to the track list. And you can see in that field both my key as well as my BPM, which is important for me because that's how I see which track I want to use next. And indeed, I now have the correct phase indicators that I personally like so much. These are a little bit better than the phase indicators that are than the blocks. I don't like the blocks, but that's just personal preference. There's nothing wrong with the blocks. It's just me liking these types of phase indicators more, which is the phase 2 indicator on Nexus 2 players. And I'm afraid Nexus 2 is the only one who has these kind of indicators. So that's how you do that. That's how you make a sort order work on CDJs and how you make sure that the data is displayed on the CDJ the way you want it to be displayed. And that makes life a little bit easier. Another cool trick I never knew, but I learned from Jeroen. If you press the dial a little bit longer, you see those double arrows come, which means you can scroll through your list at double speed. And that can be handy with longer playlists. It's just a very small sample playlist, so that won't take very much time to work on. So those were the two questions that were asked in advance prior to this stream. I don't know if there are any other questions to be asked, because then I'm happy to answer them. Let me take this one out of the way. There we are. If there are no more questions for now, then I'm going to sign off the stream, because it's not like I want to be on an hour every time. I just want to be on as long as I have information to share. For next week, I'm looking into a way to show you Big Sur on the stream. So we are diving into the new Mac OS system and what will work and what will not work and what might be needed to be fixed. So that will be the Big Sur special, basically. I also hope to show some more details about the iTunes collection tool, some new features that I'm going to add. For now, basically the same disclaimer as always. Please like, subscribe, etc. my social media outlets. Not because I want to have likes, not because I want to have many subscribers. I need those to show the companies within the DJ software and hardware industry that indeed I have a faithful following and that there is a mandate behind me, because right now my social media doesn't reflect even a fraction of my actual user base of my tools. And in order to make them understand that bugs needed to be fixed or just that features can be implemented, I need them to show my numbers, and I can show them my numbers on paper, but everybody seems to believe social media these days, and that's why I need your likes, your subscribes, etc. So please do that. There is no way that I'm going to put commercials in my videos if I can prevent that. So it's not for monetization or something else. It's just for showing how many people appreciate my endeavors on this field. For now, I do a last check if there are questions, and if not, I say farewell for this week. Thank you for watching. Mixmaster G signing off.